First one's going out.
Welcome to the Actor's Choice, where the actors and actresses have a chance to talk about themselves and their careers. Join us now for the next hour as we explore the marvelous industry of acting by actors and actresses from today's exciting show business world. And now, direct from Hollywood, here's your host, Ron Brewington.
Hi, everybody. I'm Ron Brewington on this Memorial Day, and welcome to the Actor's Choice. Brought to you by Photography as an Art, Harvey Brandman, Master Photographer, located at 1307 North San Fernando Boulevard in Burbank. And attorney Ron Irwin's new book, Haiku, Style, Passion, Heart, and author Larry Buford's book To the Future, Time Travel, Message in a Capsule, and State Farm agent Carla Green, who says, and like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Roll it.
If I confess all my sins sincerely, at the very last minute, I'm home free?
Well, technically, yes. Uh-huh. But I'd like to think...
That's great. Thank you very much. It's excellent. Excellent, Your Excellency. Thank you very much.
Hey, Joe.
Ryan, Joe, I think I found a loophole in this whole heaven-hell thing.
Wait a minute. Later, listen, I really need your advice.
You want my advice? You never want my advice.
This happens to be a really sensitive issue, and you're the only person I can talk to about it.
I guess there are some things you just can't discuss with just anyone, which is fine, Joe, that's fine, but I think I really need to tell you at the outset that I really don't have the faintest idea what I'm talking about.
I heard from Helen last night.
You're kidding me? So, I just out of the blue like that?
I was as surprised as you were. She was, well, kind of fishing around about where our relationship stood.
Oh, wow. So, what'd she say when you told her about Gail, huh?
You didn't tell her about Gail.
Oh, I was going to. I really was. I had an opening.
Glad you just couldn't be honest, could you, Joe? I'm very surprised at you. That is so me.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've just seen some of the extraordinary work by one of the most widely known directors in the business. Raised in Scranton, Pennsylvania, he made the decision to attempt a career in the entertainment industry. He got and had an education at the famed Syracuse University, then got into other training programs. Without further ado, please meet and greet Leonard R. Garner, Jr.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Oh,
it's
a pleasure
to be here.
On this Memorial Day?
Memorial Day.
Yes.
And I wore my little orange for Syracuse as well.
Hey, come on with it. Come on with it. Great to have you here today. Before we begin, we just want to let our viewers know that our other scheduled guest, Frank Dawson, had some problems and will not be here today. But we'll get him back at a future date. Okay?
Frank is also a Syracuse man, and
yes,
I missed him.
Is.
I'm missing him today.
Yes. Believe it or not, that's one of the reasons why we set it up that way. But I won't tell nobody.
Sorry.
Okay. Raised in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Born in?
Baltimore, Maryland.
Be more. All them good crabs.
Well, the Charm City.
Yes. Yeah, have a good time.
Charm City. I love the crab, and as a matter of fact, my wife and I have been talking about that recently, getting some crab shipped out here again.
Yeah.
It's hard to get that.
It is.
And a lot of people out here, they don't know the blue crab. Chesapeake Bay blue crab. They don't know what they're missing.
They don't know what they're missing.
They think that dungeon is just all that.
Garbage.
I agree with you.
Give me my blue crab.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, indeed.
I have a son that lives over in Salisbury, Maryland on the Eastern Shore.
Okay.
So I got a chance when I was in the military to know about that one. Definitely. You made a decision to be in the business.
Mm-hmm.
What made you decide what you did?
Well, believe it or not, I was in high school. I believe I was probably a junior in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And I had never participated in theater at all, anything like that. I watched a lot of television all. But we formed a little a group, some high school students, mixed race group, and we went around and we did a play about open housing in northeastern Pennsylvania. And we did it at churches, and we did it like at the county little fair thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the impact it had on the people made me want to consider getting into entertainment. Because the impact it had and the way that you could reach people that way and maybe open people's minds, it was an awakening for me.
Got you.
So
you went to school at Syracuse University?
Well, Syracuse is one of the places that I could get in without having to have a big, great background and without having to do, a lot of plays. And I went there, and it wound up being the perfect place for me. My teachers, the dean of the department, they were very, very supportive of me. And even though when I started, I was a little bit behind the curve of some of the other students there, they were just wonderful, and they were supportive, and they told me that I had something, they felt that I had something to bring. Mm-hmm. And it wound up being the right place for me.
Right. One of the famous alumni.
Yes, yes, yeah. I try to support the university.
Indeed. And then after all that, you made your way to the City of Angels.
Well, it was either New York or Los Angeles. And I didn't want to do New York. After being in Syracuse, that snow. The snow in the winters, I think my freshman year there, we had 141 inches of snow total that winter.
Wow. You know, you can make some snow ice cream while you were there.
Oh, man. We did everything. We made tunnels. We dug out where they had pushed snow up against the wall in the parking structure. We dug it out, and we partied in there. We made, like, a big hollow out, and we hang out in there. It's like a snow cavern.
Yes, yes.
So, but at any rate, I met a friend, a guy at Syracuse who was my good friend, who was mm-hmm. from Los Angeles, and he said, hey, my parents work for the school system. You can come out there this summer. We can get you a summer job. You can get your feet on the ground. I said, boom, I'm ready.
Yes.
We were supposed to be heading out here driving. He totaled the car about 20 minutes outside of Scranton.
So with you in it?
We were both in the car.
Yeah.
And it was a bad accident, but neither of us got hurt.
Amen.
And the policemen, they were shocked mm-hmm. that we were not hurt. They were more concerned at the fact that they couldn't believe it, actually. Mm-hmm. So my dad came and got us, and then the next thing I knew, Brent was back in California, and then I came out about 3 weeks later.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I couldn't get back once I got out here.
Yeah, yeah.
And the job didn't work out, so then I had to hit the ground running. Right. And I think my first job was working as a painter at a restaurant. Gotcha. I went into the restaurant and asked if they needed a waiter. Do you remember the Old World restaurant?
Oh, yes.
I went in there, and the doctor who owned it was in the back, and he said, well, we don't need a waiter. We need a painter. You know how to paint? I said, yeah, I paint. Mm-hmm. And that was my first job. I painted the outside of the restaurant.
We had another guest came here recently who did a waitress job and did those jobs that she, like you see on the movies, to get money so she could support herself.
You have to do that. Right. I mean, you know, you have to do that. I couldn't get home if I wanted to at that point. And plus the fact I was here. You know, I was determined I was not going to go back.
Oh, yeah. I saw a recent trade publication that talked about coming from New York as an actor or whatever and coming here to L.A. or vice versa. And in the opinion of the writer, he wanted people to know what was good, as he saw it, what was good about New York, what was bad about New York, what's good about L.A., what's bad about L.A. And when you sit down and read it, it makes you think.
I was just in New York for a week, about a week ago, mm-hmm. and I just went back there just to see some friends and just to be in New York. There is something fascinating about New York.
Like Broadway?
I didn't see any plays. I just saw friends, and I just mm-hmm. walked around New York. There's something about mm-hmm. New York, the energy there. I just have to get that dose every once in a while.
Did you get the hot dog?
No, I didn't do a hot dog.
Did you get the pretzels?
I didn't do any pretzels.
Did you?
I did a martini or two. That's Manhattan to me.
Yes, sir.
But no, it was, it's a great place. And for young actors, I think the difference here and there is it's very tight.
Yes.
It's very tight-knit and easy to get around. Mm-hmm. And it's a great place to observe people. I mean, now that we have our metro line, I guess you could get on there and observe. Right. But you know, the subway is a traditional place that you just go and you watch people.
Thank you.
And character study.
Yeah, because I spent a lot of time in subways. And when we had a day off, I would go to, me and my brother, we'd get on a train, stand in the front car mm-hmm. so you can see out.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd ride along the subway all day long, just watching people waving and they wave back at you.
Sit there, you know, you sit in the subway, you get your attitude right.
Yeah, right, exactly. Amen. Lennon, you got into an assistant director's training program.
Yes.
Where and when did you do that?
I got in that program in 1975. Mm-hmm. As I said, I was doing odd jobs for a while and mm-hmm. just trying to pick up work. And then I landed a job at the Department of Water and Power. And I worked there for a year.
Okay.
Because I really needed to get a car. I needed to get all these things to get myself together.
Yes.
And during that time, someone mentioned to me this assistant director's training program. I didn't even know what an assistant director really was. I had an idea of it. And I applied for the program. The year I applied, there were 1,500 people that took the test, and they accepted 15. And I was fortunate enough to be one of the 15. Mm. So the program trains you to be an assistant director, but they provide you work. You have to work for 400 working days. Mm-hmm. And after the 400 working days, you get in the Directors Guild as a second AD.
Okay.
During that time, the program will move you to different shows or movies. You're working with different assistant directing teams, and you're learning production from the ground up.
You get paid?
You get paid. It's actually when I started, I think I started, my starting salary was a little less than unemployment. But you get a bump every 100 days.
Yes.
Yeah. And the program, once you're in the guild, they don't find you work, but they provide you work during it. And it's the people that you're working with as you're training, that those are the ones that are going to, you're going to wind up working with, hopefully.
Gotcha.
After you get in the program.
Sounds like a good program.
It is a good program. I was on the board of the program for 14 years.
Wow.
And every once in a while, I think, I don't know if I'll go back or not, but sometimes nice to get some new blood in there, I thought. But it's a great program. Yeah. The program came about as a way to provide opportunity for minorities and mm-hmm. women, because up until that point, you became an assistant director if your daddy was in the business, or if your, you know, nepotism, however you want to call it. And that was a way to try to get
it. It has never changed.
No.
It's never
but it's opened up a lot more now.
Right.
And so some of the early female assistant directors came through the program, and mm-hmm. black assistant directors.
Gotcha.
It was great. I loved it. Mm-hmm. And it changed. As much as I wanted to act, when I got there in 1975, 76, when I was training, there weren't a lot of black people doing that.
Right.
And it just opened my eyes. I loved the idea of being on set, of being helping drive the machinery that makes it go. Mm-hmm. And so then I decided I was going to do that for a while, devote to that. And also, once I was in the program, I couldn't really act anyway, because that was a full-time thing.
Gotcha. But being on that board, that's giving back. Thank you, Leonard. That's giving back.
Yeah, I enjoyed it, too. It's very enjoyable. Yeah. And I've been on the board of the country school where my kids, when I was on the board, I was actually chairman of the board chair for a year as well. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
Excellent. Okay. 1977, you got your first IMDb job as the second associate director in a movie called The Happy Hooker Goes to Washington.
Second AD on The Happy Hooker Goes to Washington. There was a gentleman, John Patterson, who wound up becoming a very, very good director and did many episodes of The Sopranos, as mm-hmm. a matter of fact. John is gone now, rest his soul. But John, I had worked with, he was the first AD, and I had worked with him before, during the Rockford Files a couple times. Mm-hmm. And when I got out of the program, he gave me my first job as a second AD, and it was great. George Hamilton
I can just say it now.
Joey Heatherton. We were hot, they were hot.
Oh, yes, they were.
They were hot.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a lot of fun. Mm. A lot of fun.
Mm. And then in 1980, you got a career start as an actor in the Blues Brothers as a lobby guard.
Yeah, you know, that came about because of John Landis. Now, I had been in Chicago. I was the second AD on the movie, and the first AD and I went to Chicago mm-hmm. to do pre-production. And we were scouting all kind of locations, and we were testing the speed, the bullet car, and all the different things we needed. Mm-hmm. And we go to the main, where at the end of the movie, the main city hall, mm-hmm. and we're in there scouting, and John Landis goes, okay, this desk here, there's going to be two guards. One of them's going to be Lenny Garner, he's going to have lines. He knew I had an acting background, so somehow he just said, I said, okay, John, that's fine. You can do it. Sure enough, I was a second AD that day. I sat background, I had all the cops running around doing all that, ran up on my little uniform, did my line, but that's how I got my Screen Actors Guild card. So that's how I got it.
Glad you tell it, because we get a lot of young people to watch this show. And this, I would say, not secrets, but these are things that normally happen in the business. It's who you know, who knows you.
It's like, to me, it's like a river. I always say, if you're sitting by a river and the river's going by, it's just going by. You got to get in the water, now the river's taking you somewhere, and then you'll see where you're going to wind up. Mm. You get in the flow.
Mm. Come on, river. And while we talk, we got some time, let's take a look at one of your big screen. Now, here's the storyline. You're an Uber driver who has a Latvian passenger in New Orleans. Please take it from there.
Yeah, what happens is my character is a Uber driver.
Mm-hmm.
His son has kind of helped him get this Uber thing. You know, mm-hmm. he's an older gentleman. And he picks up this Latvian woman, and it really is a story of miscommunication. You know, she has no idea quite where he's coming from, and he's so off in his own world, he has no idea where she's coming from, and it leads to a very strange set of events, let's say that.
Well, we got a little shortcut. Here it is, Once in Louisiana.
Okay. Roll it.
Happy Mardi Gras.
Happy Mardi Gras.
Please help yourself. Water a cannon behind mine and pass to sea. Boy, I can't believe this is the last day. You know thousands and thousands of people leave town, and I'm usually one of them. But this year, I don't know why I made this mistake. You know, my son, he left too. But I think, you know, maybe I could make a little extra cash. But Uber doesn't accept cash. Well, can you imagine? I picked up two drunks at 2 a.m. down in the French Quarter yesterday. You've been in the French Quarter, right? Well, they puked all over my car and didn't even apologize. You know, I'm only 65 this year.
That was nice.
I hope everybody out there has had that experience you get a driver and the driver is just kind of in his own world. He starts talking, you'd be like, am I going to get where I'm going or what's going on? But it was a lot of fun to do. Yes. It was very, very much fun to do.
Good.
And the director was a woman, graduate student from Cal Arts Valencia. Mm-hmm. And we shot that in a night.
In one night?
Yeah, driving around. It was real time driving and it was fun. A lot of fun.
The things that people do in this business.
Just fun, you know, just having fun. Love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yes. I gotta say that while you were acting, you were still working in other positions, either as a second assistant director or an assistant director.
Correct.
All this at the same time.
Yes, and there was a point when particularly once I got in the multi-camera, I had the opportunity. There's hiatus weeks built in,
right.
So I could audition on things, I could get out, I could do things. Yeah, I was trying to do them both as long as I could. Mm. The height of my acting career at that time, I got cast in a pilot for CBS called Kingpins, and that was starred Dorian Harwood, mm-hmm. David Alan Greer, Jita Kumbuka. Wait a minute, I can see him right now. He was in She's Gotta Have It, Tommy Hicks.
Tommy Hicks, now deceased, yes.
Yeah. No, Tommy's still with us.
I'm thinking Tommy Ford.
You're thinking Tommy Ford. Tommy's still with us.
Sorry, Tommy.
And we were hot. We did the pilot that night. It was shot. Mm-hmm. Everybody, CBS West Coast, loved it, thought it was going to go. New York Monday said no, they weren't going to put it on the air. So that was the heartbreak that's what an actor goes through, though. You know, things happen, you're close, you think you're close, and then it's gone.
Okay, 1987, still doing the other things, but you started working as a stage manager on the TV series Hard Knocks.
Yeah, that was at Paramount. I started at Paramount. The first thing I did at Paramount was when I did a lot of single camera as an assistant director.
Okay.
And then I met a woman named Linda McMurray through another friend, and I became her second AD on a show called Joanie Loves Chachi, and so that's when I got introduced to the multi-camera world. Mm. And all those shows were done in front of a live audience.
Okay.
And it was a whole nother thing for me. It blends theater, live theater, with television. It's not quite live television, but it's there. You have to learn to block, you have to learn to vamp, things are changing, you have to learn to change your shots quickly. And I found it fascinating. I loved it. I loved it. Mm. And so then I went back, I did some single camera again. And the last really big single camera thing was the first AD on Miami Vice, the first season. And I did two episodes. I think they went through 10 first assistant directors that first season.
Wow.
Because they were super ambitious, and they would blame it on you if it didn't the schedule. You went over schedule, they'd blame it on the AD.
Okay.
And I came back, and from that point on, I was at Paramount pretty much from there until probably 1996. That was my base.
Hmm.
And I acted, and I AD'd, and I started directing there.
Wow, all at one time.
Well, over a period of time.
Mm-hmm. Can we go back for just a second? Getting people to come to these shows that you're doing, how do you get tickets? How do you get it?
They're easy to do. You can just, they have audience services.
Okay.
And you know, most of the studios now even have an audience service. You can just call in and say you want to get tickets. Sometimes they pass them out at different, like, you know, Universal City, places like that.
Okay.
But that's how you get in. It's pretty easy. I mean, unless it's something like Ellen DeGeneres, right, or something like that, those shows are pretty easy to get into.
Okay. And it's interesting, I've been there many times. What you see on the screen is not the way it happened inside the studio. Can you talk about that?
Well, you know, what happens, there is the editing process.
Yes, yes.
And what you see, and depending on when you see it too.
Right.
I mean, there was a time when the audience couldn't even see what the cameras were seeing, mm-hmm, when I first started. And then now you can pretty much see through the lens. But there was a time when there was a lens beside the lens. So what the audience was seeing wasn't exactly what was being seen through the lens in the film days before it started to get digital.
Gotcha.
And then there's the editing process. I mean, every show you do is anywhere between 2 to 5 minutes long. 5 minutes is horrible. 2.5 minutes is about perfect. And then that's 2.5 minutes that's got to be edited out of the show.
Okay.
So some of the jokes you've seen, part of things are going to change. They're not going to be there. And also things will happen on set that will not be scripted, that sometimes will happen and it'll be so funny that will overwrite what was in the script.
Right. I enjoyed it because you see so many professional people all working click, clock, click, like everybody know what they're doing.
It's a sport. I view it as a sport. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a team sport.
Okay.
And the director is sort of like, I guess you could call him a manager. I don't know. The director is there heading the team on the floor. You've got your writers and producers, and they're there, and they can change jokes, they can change things.
Mm-hmm.
But then the director is, I'm changing shots, but the whole team, it's a flow, it gets a flow.
Yes.
And that's what I love about it.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, if you've never been to one of these shows, you're missing something.
And audience shows, I really think that a lot of us can laughter. Ron asked me when he saw that, is that a real audience? I think you can tell if it's a real audience. And I think a real audience is a wonderful thing, and you can tell by the actors because they're getting that energy from the audience. Mm-hmm. I always call it the 200-person generator, or however how many people there are.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see how long. You know, it's died 4 times in my career, I think, multiple camera,
right,
supposedly.
While you were doing all this work, you were really building up your resume, weren't you?
I was working and working.
All right.
I like to work.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Get in line. So do I.
I had a hunch.
Yeah,
I had a hunch, yeah, you did.
It's my favorite, one of my favorite four-letter words.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like the word. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like
ideas is another one of my favorite words.
Ideas.
A lot of things get done when you think about it.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Gosh.
Right.
Gosh.
Mm-hmm.
Also in 1987, you got a job as a full director doing 3 episodes through 1989 in a project called Brothers.
I was the stage manager on Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Brothers was the first gay sitcom in America, probably the world, I don't know. It was for Showtime.
Yeah.
It ran from 1985 through 1989. Mm. Actually, 84, I believe it started.
Okay.
And I was a stage manager on the show. I filled in 1 episode of the very first season, left to do Miami Vice, came back from Miami, and they wanted to replace the stage manager, and I took over as the stage manager on,
wow,
the show. And that led me to, I would do parts on the show, I would stage manage as well, and then I got the opportunity to direct 3 episodes as well.
Mm.
So that was a tape show, and I was in a booth. I didn't really like the booth as much as I like being on the floor.
Yes.
I like to be able to talk to my actors directly. When you're in the booth, you're always the stage. When you're a stage manager, it's a great learning experience as a director, because the director is in your ear telling you, giving notes to the actors, giving things that he wants.
Right.
He can come over, there's an essay button, he can speak through a loudspeaker to,
yes,
say it, but he's coming through your ear. So sometimes you have to translate.
Yes.
And it's a great experience because you learn how to, the actor's looking at you, what is he saying?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
What is he saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he's cussing in your ear and you're going, well, I can't say that. Well, let me see how I'm gonna phrase this. So it helps,
wow,
teach you.
Wow. I mean, because you're sitting there, they're having conversations, just regular conversations, like what they did last night, what are they going to do tonight? And then, all right, stand by, action, and they just go right to it like nothing, never happened. Ugh.
That's a beautiful thing.
It
was the same thing with the crew.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Everybody's like over here, okay, let's go, we ready, let's go, ready,
rolling,
let's go, boom, we're on, bow,
ugh,
do it.
Amazing.
It's a beautiful thing.
Amazing.
Beautiful thing.
Wow. Let's see. And last, while you all this was going on, you worked as a unit production manager for the hit TV series Rock.
Yeah, well, see, that's a credit they say that, but I really think I was the first AD. I did another show as a production manager first, but I don't think it was Rock.
Okay.
I did the pilot with James Burroughs. We did the pilot for Rock, and Rock went on to have a wonderful career, and I worked with Charles again on another show.
Yes.
I was an assistant director on a show called Laurel Avenue for HBO that Charles produced.
Charles Dutton.
Yeah. Wonderful man.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful man.
The lady who played his wife, she was great.
Oh, she's great. Yeah. She's great.
And the fellow who played his brother?
He's still working.
He's still working at NCIS.
Yes.
Been there a long time.
Long time. Great actor.
Yeah, good actor.
Good guy. Great people, man.
Yeah.
Great people.
That's why we love this business. You know, you see a lot of people, you meet them. You're actor to actor, friend to friend. You do me, I do you. It's something going
on. It's something going on. Yeah. And that's the thing about it. The other thing about the sitcom, everybody's there.
Because that's your specialty. If you're
doing a movie,
right?
You know, some actors might not even see each other in the same movie.
Wow.
I mean, if they're doing scenes together, but sometimes they're not, you know, because it's all... But in a sitcom, because you're doing a play, everybody's there.
Mm.
And so everybody's interacting, and that's one of the things I love about it.
Wow. We got to take a break a little bit. Before we go to break, let's take a look at you in 1999 to 2000, directing Becca. Roll it.
Sometimes I feel like the last civilized person in this city. You know, all I wanted to do was go to the movies. I barely get past the opening credits before every schmuck in the theater decides to host his own talk show. I finally just had to walk out. You know, whatever happened to common courtesy? I swear, people have absolutely no regard for anybody but themselves.
All right, let me guess here. You wanted to save a nickel, so you went to the bargain matinee.
So? So, that was your first mistake. Matinee bring out the rabble, your low rent types, your hardcore unemployable. Not to mention all those old pudding junkies who barely know they've left the house. Spend the buck, go later in the day, it weeds out the riffraff.
Yeah, you gotta admit, John, when it comes to riffraff, he's a man.
So what movie was it anyway?
Lethal Vision.
Oh, I saw that movie! It's incredible! Didn't you love the ending where the guy's hanging from the roof and
I just said I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, I haven't either.
Well, you know, first everybody talks during the movie, now you want to ruin the ending. You know, there used to be a moviegoer's code of conduct. You shut up in the movie, you shut up about the movie. And Bob's a general rule, just shut up. Hey, where's my coffee? Reg, coffee!
Ladies and gentlemen, that was the work of Leonard R. Garner,
it's
Jr.
It's good to see all those faces again. I had a lot of fun with those people. And that's the other thing, is you look back and you look at all the people you've had the opportunity to work with and the fun you had. It's really... Really good.
Okay.
Really good.
I'm Ron Brewington, and this is The Actor's Choice. The studio of Harvey Brandman Photography as an Art is proud to offer you a $100 discount off any photo package valued at $300 or more. Now, Harvey's been in the business for nearly a quarter of a century, and he certainly knows how to take care of his customers. So, please give him a call today at 818-954-9294. That's 818-954-9294. You'll be glad you did. And by the way, please tell Harvey that you heard about his offer right here on The Actor's Choice. Haiku Style, Passion, Heart is the latest release from author and attorney Ron Irwin. The book was inspired by the author's first exposure to haiku well over half a century ago. This experience produced within him a deep passion to experience Asia, which he later did as a U.S. Marine. The book is available in paperback at lulu.com. That's lulu.com. Now, Irwin says he'll give 20% of net book sales split evenly between the veterans of foreign wars and Vietnam veterans of America. Book to the Future, Time Travel, Message in a Capsule. It's a book by author Larry Buford. It's a historical and faith-based account of how what we do and follow today will affect us tomorrow. The author also calls it an adventure for those who want to travel back through time. The book is now available in paperback for only $17.95 from Amazon. So please get your copy today. And now, a word from State Farm agent Carla Green. Roll it.
Let me ask you something. What do you see when you look at your home and your car? Do you see a bundle? A combo deal? That's how other insurance companies see them. But a State Farm agent sees so much more. Because the State Farm agent sees your home and your car as more than just four walls and four wheels. They see the things you've worked really hard for. So why not give them the protection they deserve? Let me help you with that. Give me a call. State Farm agent Carla Green, 213-239-9675. I look forward to speaking with you.
Thanks, Carla. And like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. For more information, call 213-239-9675. That's 213-239-9675. And finally, if you have a product, a service, or upcoming event that you'd like to see advertised on this program, please call 323-533-1036. That's 323-533-1036. Our prices are very affordable. Thank you. This is the Actors' Choice. I'm your host, Ron Brewington, with our guest director, Leonard R. Garner, Jr. Roll it.
Here's the key. Now, I'll be back Sunday night, so you'll need to feed the turtle twice. Now, remember, place. Don't drop the food in the tank or you'll spook Shelly. I call him Shelly. The number to the pet hospital is on the fridge. Maya, are you listening to me?
Yeah, feed Smelly.
What's going on?
I'm pulling a practical joke on Finch.
Oh, really?
Hey, have any of you freaks seen my soda?
Did you check the fridge?
I already looked in this stupid fridge.
In or on?
You put my soda on top of the refrigerator.
That was a classic. I wish I had a camera.
That was the most pathetic thing I've ever seen.
Oh, I'm sorry. No hard feelings here. Have some peanut brittle.
I wonder what's going to happen. It's peanut brittle.
I don't get it.
Check the expiration date.
Okay, well, that was great. Look at all your work. You've done a lot of stuff.
Had a lot of fun with that gang, too.
What's your signature? How do I know the Garner signature?
That is a good question. Well, if you hear my laugh, you'll know it, but in sitcoms, it's very hard to have a signature because there's a certain format that you're operating in. Okay. But I would say movement.
Okay.
You know, I love all those shows that you've shown so far. I had dollies. I had four camera dollies, which they don't even hardly use anymore. You might get one or two now out of your four cameras. And I love the dolly. I love being able to move the camera as well as the people. I love the counter. I love the flow. So that's one of the things you'd see in a lot of that work. And this also an energy. That's all I can say.
Okay.
I had an editor one time tell me. He said, "I can tell your episode. There's an energy. The actors have an energy. There's something." So I don't know.
Yeah, makes you feel good, though.
It does make me feel good.
Yeah.
It's also when you come up with business, when you come up with jokes.
Okay.
When you come up with added things, you know, you have a script, and you can't rewrite all the lines in the script. You can, things that aren't working, you can adjust like that, but you're trying to stick with the script at least initially to show them when you get to the run through. But you can add extra business. If you can come up with a bit, it's when you come up with those bits, when you come up with those things that make an extra laugh, A, it helps prove to the actors, that go, this guy, he knows funny. He knows funny. They trust you more, that you come up with more. That's what you work for.
Wow. There's responsibilities also that go with being a director. I mean, anyone can say, ready and action. But there are responsibilities. Can you talk about some of those responsibilities?
Well, one of them is, you know, to know you're the man in control. Everything should go through you. You have to talk to the actors. You have to inspire them. You have to come up with, you have to try to come up with ideas. You have to try to set the tone of the stage. Having been a first AD, that helped me on stage in terms of running the crew part of it. But the same, it can be said with the actors. You know, they have to trust you. They have to be trust you're funny if you're doing comedy. Mm-hmm. And you have to be able to, sometimes you get into a disagreement, you have to convince them to try your way, give it a try, let's do this, that's not working, maybe we try this. I learned a very valuable lesson from an actor when I first started directing. And he told me, he says, you know, there's a little bit less of the I want you to do this, I think we should do that. Try the we. So one of my things is, you know, maybe we should, I liked how that was going so far. Maybe we should try it like this, or maybe if we did this, or let's look at trying that, just to, because it is a team sport.
Okay.
And you can be, obviously you have to be in control, but to try to create an atmosphere where people feel safe and they want to try stuff, that's the way I like to operate.
Gotcha. You got to worry about budget?
Well, yeah, you have to worry about budget. I don't have to worry about, they tell me what I got.
Okay.
And you'll go and you know the parameters. We like to be out by this time. We're going to be in overtime when you go into here, blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. So I will ask for things that I need. If I can convince them that I need it, it's going to make the show better. I will ask for those things if I can get them. But budget is not the first thing in my mind, but it's always in my mind. Particularly now, I've been doing a lot of Disney shows with kids. Kids create a whole nother thing. You know, you have less time with them and they have to have school and you're always up against the wall and they have a hard out. You can't, overtime won't work with them.
You ever think about something that you've done that someone is going to copy, copycats? Particularly when it's something bad.
That's an interesting question. Something that I've done that someone's going to copy, bad.
Yeah. Like killing somebody.
You mean real life?
Yeah, real life. They saw it on I saw it on TV. Says, I'm going to do it.
Well, you know, look at just the other day. You know, I worked on the Blues Brothers.
Uh-huh.
So there's a scene in the Blues Brothers where the Blues Brothers take the Bluesmobile and they jump up over the drawbridge.
Right.
The drawbridge going up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, these knuckleheads down in Louisiana got killed 2 days ago.
That's right.
Trying to go up over the drawbridge.
Yeah.
I don't know if they saw the movie or not. I
yes.
have no idea if they saw the movie. But don't do that at home. It's
yeah.
not safe. It's not safe to do that.
Right.
Okay. I can tell you, we took days and days getting that set up to do that stunt on the movie.
Interesting. Responsibilities. Wow.
And you wonder now, that's part of the thing now with all the internet and YouTube and everything.
Yes.
Some people just see things and I don't know if they think it through now.
Because we spend so many hours in front of the television. I mean, one of the things that I teach at Santa Monica College is the power of the media.
Mm-hmm.
It's powerful. You know that. I know that. We see that all the time.
Yeah, it's very powerful.
Very powerful.
Sometimes I'm a little disappointed.
Sometimes, yeah. I can believe that. Tell us some, take us from the beginning. How's it all put together from beginning, middle, and end of a show?
Okay, well, from the director's point of view?
Director's point of view.
Okay, depending on if it's a pilot or not, there's different things that are happening. I did the pilot to the show Girlfriends. A pilot is its own thing. And the pilot, the director is there. Once you are hired as a director on the pilot, you are there from the very beginning. Now, they will have a script already, or at least they'll start working with a script. Mm-hmm. But you are involved in set design, in casting, and all that.
Mm-hmm.
You are involved in those elements as well, not in the pilot, but in the pilot, you are involved in setting the initial template, so to speak.
Yes.
On a regular episode, I could get my script anywhere from, I have gotten scripts anywhere from 2 weeks in advance to I have gotten a script the morning of the production meeting table read. So what happens is the director gets his script. Whenever you get that script, if you get it in time, you're going to go to the studio. You're going to try to, they're going to send you drawings, stage dimensions and whatnot and sets. But I find you really want to go and try to get to the set. I like to physically see it. I like to try to physically meet the actors. I try to meet the producers and have conversation with them before. Sometimes that's possible, sometimes it's not. But the first step is I get the script, I read it, I have my ideas. You know, if I've seen the set, I have my ideas of what, I've watched episodes of the show, so I know the rhythm, I know the cast. And so the first day, you show up at work, and the first thing you have is called a production meeting, where all the department heads gather around the table and you go through the script. The first AD usually leads the production meeting.
Right.
And you go through the script page by page for effects, props, all these different things. The production meeting's over. The next thing is a table read. Table read, the actors gather around the table with the producers and the network and you read the script. I would read the stage directions and the actors will be in character. and we'll do it. And after that, then you have notes. The network will give you notes on the performances or notes on the script, you and the producers. And then after that, then you start your first rehearsal. Sometimes you go right to work. Sometimes they'll say, well, we're going to work on the second act, so you can only rehearse so many scenes. And so you'll go to work that day. And you'll rehearse as much as you can.
Gotcha.
And the next day, you come in, you rehearse with the actors again. The end of the day, you have your first run-through. You have your producer run-through. So mm-hmm. the writer-producers come down, they sit there, they watch it like a play. Mm-hmm. They go from set to set as you do it. And then you have notes at the end of the day. And then you go home, you go back to the office with the guys, you know, you talk about things.
Right.
You come in the third day, and that is your network studio run-through. So I will rehearse all day long again. And then this run through, the writer, producers, and the studio, whoever's representing the studio and the network, they will come and watch it. And after that run through, there are notes. Sometimes they'll give the notes to the cast as the run through is going on. Sometimes they'll wait and do the whole run through and do it afterwards. And then the fourth day, after that day, that night, that's when our director really does his homework, because the next day the cameras are coming in.
Gotcha.
And you're gonna start to block the show. So that night now, once you know what's changed or might change, you start camera blocking where your camera's going to be, start doing your shots. And then the next day that morning, you come in and you block with, you have second team, which is your stand-ins. And in a lot of cases, you'll block with stand-ins first while the actors, it depends on if you're going to be pre-shooting anything or not. Mm-hmm. But you will come in with cameras and you will block each scene. And you take the time to block it, and then you'll run it a couple of times and move to the next one. And then Friday you come in, and depending, sometimes on Thursday you will be pre-shooting stuff, which means you won't get to block everything that day. Mm-hmm. So you'll block up to a point, you'll pre-shoot stuff. You come in Friday morning, anything that you have left to block, you'll do Friday. Well, not morning, you'll come in later in the day because you're going to have an audience show if it's a Friday show. Now that's the other thing. Our shows go either, they either shoot on Tuesday or Friday.
Okay.
And the reason for that was because of multiple camera shows, they would try to use the camera crew on two shows a week. Okay. So you would have one show that would start on Wednesday and would shoot, would go Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, rehearsal, Monday, Tuesday, blocking and shooting. And then the other show would start Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday, Friday with blocking and shooting. So the camera guys would work on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. So, and then Friday, you come in, you rehearse again with the cast. Sometimes you have a run-through for producers. When I started, they used to have a run-through with producers before the show. A lot of times you don't do that now. You'll just go ahead and run the scenes, get everybody up to speed. You take a break, you have your lunch, late lunch, the audience comes in at, if it's a 5 o'clock show, the audience comes in at 4, 3:34. If it's a later show, when I started on Wings, I think our shows were like 7.
A.M. or P.M.?
P.M. Okay. So you would, you know, you might start at like 11 in the afternoon and you work up to a point, you have your lunch break, you come back, the audience loads in, and then you do the show. And you're usually out with 7 show, we usually be out by 11 o'clock.
Amazing.
It's a machine.
Right.
It's fun.
Right. We just turn on the TV and there's a show. You know, it's just all, see the credits and that's it.
It's something that's very unusual. There's not a lot of sitcom directors out there. There's a lot more movie directors than there are sitcom directors.
Gotcha.
It's a special niche.
Okay. So keeping that in mind, there's a lot of talent out there, as you know. Tell us about the competition among the directors.
Oh, it's ongoing. It's ongoing, and it's not just talent as well. I mean, you know, as you're working, I mean, the longer you work, then the more you start, there's younger people nipping at your heels all the time. And it is very competitive, but there's a lot of work. When there's a lot of work, then there's a lot of opportunities from people. When the sitcom world starts, it looks like it's retreating, then all of a sudden people start going to other venues, possibly. But yeah, there's always somebody watching you, and there's always someone that's observing you. I mean, and it's one of the things that you do. I mean, I've had many people observe me, ask me questions, come and sit and watch me work and ask me questions. And you know they're trying to eventually want to take your job.
Wow. Dull.
But then, you know, you can't think about that. Right. You just do what you do.
Right. You've been doing how long now?
I've been directing since 88. I did the first Brothers, but I really consider my directing career started when I stopped first ADing, and that was in 1994.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
A long time. Getting and keeping a reputation as a director.
If you're doing comedy, you better have some comedy form.
Right.
You better, my reputation, I think, would be that I always have a fun, lively set, mm-hmm. that I know how to get performances out of actors, that I know how to enhance comedy, and I'm easy to work with.
Outstanding. We just lost a good director, John Singleton.
Yeah, sad, very sad. Very sad, and I posted on Facebook after that happened how important it is, particularly for African American men. Mm-hmm. Please take your health. You know, your health is paramount. You know, we all hear that.
Right.
I was a young man. I heard that. It didn't mean anything to me.
Right. Mm-hmm. And now it does.
Now it does.
Yeah.
And it should always. I had a very serious illness in 1980. I was 28 years old. Mm-hmm. I was in the hospital for 7 weeks. Mm-hmm. I was an outpatient for 6 weeks. That changed my life in terms of I'm not a hypochondriac,
right.
But if something's happening to me, I'm not praying on it and waiting. I'm going to go get it checked out. Hmm. I get my physical every year. Yeah. And I think it's important. I think it's important people do that.
Right.
Okay, do that.
Yes. I always like to say the best thing that God ever did to us, he brought us in this world. But the next best thing is to have good health.
Good health.
And have that good health. Mm. What's a typical day for you?
When I'm working? I get up, and depending on what time I have to be there, I'm always like to get in early. I like to get there and you know, you walk in, you hit craft service first thing.
Craft service!
You know, you're walking to the stage, you're saying hi to the people you're seeing, you're walking through the door, people are saying hi to you, the grips are working already, you hit craft service,
right.
You get your little burrito, whatever it is you want. And I get out on the set, pull my pages out, and talking to the first AD already, waiting on the actors to come in. I'm jazzed. I'm hyped. I'm ready to go. I'm excited. It is exciting. I mean,
yes.
it's just, I love it.
Yes. We only have a few minutes left, but before we go, we want to see the last movie that you did. It was called Raven's Home. Roll it.
They say home is where the heart is.
Yeah, we got heart and a whole bunch of us.
Man, I'm going to kick your bra.
That's why I need privacy. There's my twin sister.
It's Nathan!
My mom's best friend.
Where's my kids?
Her kids make good choices.
Our neighbor,
what up, kids?
And then there are my psychic
digits.
I saw the future.
The weirdest thing happened.
It's not always about you, Booker.
Raven's Home!
A new series. You know, working with Disney, doing a lot of shows for Disney, mm-hmm. I've worked with a lot of kids now. And at first, I hadn't worked with a lot of kids.
Right.
And it's so much fun. That's another one. When you get kids, kids are very talented. They can be very talented. But they're still figuring things out. They need a little help, and you're trying to give them notes, and mm-hmm. then it's nothing better when you give them a note, and then all of a sudden they turn it on, and you're like, wow.
Wow.
Before
you leave, you got to say something about Ruth E. Carter, please.
You know, Ruth and I worked together in the past, and I cannot remember on what it was, and I haven't seen Ruth in a long time.
Yes.
But you talk about deserving the awards she received.
Oh, yeah.
But not only that,
yes.
how great the work was. Mm-hmm. She's always been a pleasure to work with, always done great work, mm-hmm. and she got the award for what is the best work of her life, I think. It's mm-hmm. really amazing, and I'm very happy for her.
Right.
Very happy for her.
Leonard R. Garner, Jr., how do you want to be remembered?
Well, I want to be remembered as a good director. Mm-hmm. I want to be remembered as a good director. I want to be with my acting thing. We'll see if that goes on some more or not. I want to be remembered as a good person, as a good father. As a good man,
mm-hmm.
I love the business. I've given it my all. The business is not everything to me, though. It's not all consuming. My family and my life are a big part of that. I like to be in it, and then I like to pull back and get away from it. I like to do both.
Mm-hmm. May I have your right hand, please?
Yes.
This is my trademark. I always give people a silver dollar for good luck.
Oh, I love that. I love it.
And it's never be broke.
And it's an Eisenhower on there, too. How about that? Eisenhower silver dollar. I like that a lot. Yeah. Thank you, Ron, very much. It's been a pleasure.
Been a pleasure. Hope we can get you back again. We still haven't gone through all the questions.
Hey, you know, I know he had a ton of questions. I was like, Ron's going to question me to death. And the time has really flown by.
It has when you're having fun.
We're having fun. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I hope everybody out there gains something from this.
Yes.
And it's been fun. Thank you very much.
Yes. Special thanks to our sponsors, Harvey Brandman Photography is an Art, Ron Irwin's Haiku, Style, Passion, Heart, Larry Buford's Book to the Future, Time Travel, Message in a Capsule, and State Farm agent Carla Green. Again, much thanks to our guest today, Director Leonard R. Garner, Jr. Love to have you back again, sir.
I would come back anytime, Ron. Plus, you're right in the neighborhood. You know, I love that.
Understand. And, of course, special thanks to our ever-growing audience. Take care, and we'll see you next time.